The momentary thought, you know, let him get closer, and then it hit me, hell no, shoot, and I did.
Everybody was shooting at us. And all of a sudden, zeros started flashing by from under my belly. Six or eight of them, I don't know how many.
I heard some rumbling underneath. Then fire and smoke came up all of a sudden. The cockpit was engulfed in flames.
As we pulled away from the carrier, I was looking right straight at the side of it, and the carrier was on fire.
I remember feeling three or four direct hits on our ship. I thought this could be my end.
That kind of action gets the adrenaline pumping and keeps you up, and all of a sudden it's over. But the thing that I knew was that a lot of the guys weren't coming back.
It was the greatest naval battle of World War II. And in the course of less than 48 hours, the future of two world powers would be forever changed. Barely more than a pinpoint in the vast Pacific Ocean, Midway Atoll is the last sentry between Asia and the Hawaiian Islands. A tiny but critically essential strategic outpost for the United States Navy. In May 1942, American forces prepare to defend this spit of land at all costs, in a battle they cannot afford to lose. Yet by all odds, they are charged with an impossible task: hold off an overwhelmingly powerful military machine that has so far proven to be invincible. For over a decade, Japan has been building its war machine to pursue a grand strategy to conquer China, Asia, and the Pacific Islands. With each victory, their powerful and sophisticated army and navy grow stronger and more confident. In the spring of 1940, with most of Europe overrun by Nazi Germany, Japan signs a pact with Adolf Hitler, granting the Japanese a free hand in their conquest of Asia. Only the United States, with strong economic and political interests throughout the region, stands in the way. But their armed forces are not prepared for war. December 7th, 1941. A Japanese armada arrives undetected in the waters off the Hawaiian Islands. Their mission? Destroy the U.S. Pacific Fleet moored at Pearl Harbor and remove the last obstacle to their total domination of Asia.
It looks so peaceful. I question myself if we should attack them. But at the same time, I thought we've got them.
Just as the Japanese had hoped, American forces are caught completely by surprise. The next day, the United States declares war on Japan.
We came back into Pearl Harbor, I think, on the afternoon of the 10th. Battleship roll, still smoking, and Ford Island. The hangars were pretty well blown apart. Wrecked aircraft all over the place.
The water was pretty well covered with oil. And pretty much a scene of desolation.
I was humiliated and embarrassed by our being caught at Pearl. You know, I shared the feeling of responsibility that we never should have been caught that way.
The The Japanese have inflicted a devastating blow to the U.S. Pacific Fleet. But in an incredible stroke of luck, three American carriers that were supposed to be at Pearl Harbor that weekend were all out at sea.
We were very fortunate on the Enterprise by not being in there because we were supposed to have been in there. And if we'd have been in there, I wouldn't have been alive today.
The Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor with carrier-based planes, demonstrating the crucial role aircraft carriers will play in modern warfare. Yet they had failed to touch any of America's carriers. It was the first of many twists of fate that would come back to haunt the Japanese in the Battle of Midway. And for the young men aboard the U.S. carriers, men with no experience of war, the future of their nation now rests squarely on their shoulders. Within weeks of Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor, the remnants of America's Pacific Fleet attempt to strike back. But the best they can do is harass the overpowering Japanese forces in such remote areas as the Solomon and Marshall Islands. Worse for the Americans, the hit-and-run skirmishes expose just how unprepared they are for war.
About 70% of our pilots were real green pilots right out of the States. They had very little experience. We had to go into the Solomon Islands with people like that.
The odds are stacked against the Americans. They are vastly outnumbered in both ships and personnel, and their fighter planes are no match for the state-of-the-art Japanese Zero.
One of the things we began to realize was the maneuverability. It was a good fighter. It was far better than any of the fighters we had.
With Japan's domination of Asia nearly complete and their navy able to strike at will throughout the Western Pacific, U.S. military leaders decide to execute a risky attempt to keep the pressure on the enemy and boost American morale during the darkest days of the war. 16 B-25 land bombers, under the command of Lieutenant Colonel James Doolittle, lumber off the deck of the carrier Hornet and mount a daring raid into the heart of Japan and bomb Tokyo. The surprise bombing electrifies the Japanese. The nation and their revered emperor are no longer safe from enemy attack.
To have them bomb Tokyo, where the imperial palace is, the navy had to do something to save face.
The honor of the emperor and the security of his people becomes the responsibility of this man, Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, mastermind behind the attack on Pearl Harbor. Yamamoto knows the United States is a sleeping giant, with a war potential far greater than that of Japan. Doolittle's raid convinces him now is the time to deliver a decisive blow to the carriers he missed at Pearl Harbor. He chooses tiny Midway Atoll as bait in an elaborate trap. Four of Japan's finest aircraft carriers will be at the heart of the mightiest battle fleet the world has ever seen. Yamamoto will divide his forces to confuse and surprise the Americans. First, he will attack the Aleutian Islands, a decoy designed to split the American Pacific Fleet. Then the four carriers will launch their planes and bomb Midway Atoll, destroying all U.S. resistance to a full-scale invasion. Yamamoto is convinced the Americans will have no choice but to try to reclaim the airbase at Midway, a strategically vital defense post for the Hawaiian Islands. And when the Americans come to the rescue, a vast array of Japanese warships held in reserve will pounce and wipe out the unsuspecting Pacific Fleet. It is a complex and daring strategy, and its success completely depends on catching the enemy off guard. Although Yamamoto will be deploying a massive armada of men, ships, and planes, the U.S. has a secret weapon, naval intelligence. Codebreakers have succeeded in cracking portions of Japan's top-secret naval code. In April of 1942, intelligence officers report startling news to Admiral Chester Nimitz, commander of the Pacific Fleet. They believe the Japanese are planning a mammoth sea operation, using the code names AL and AF for their intended targets. But intelligence can only partially decipher the code. They are fairly sure AL refers to the Aleutian Islands, yet can only guess that AF is Midway. Nimitz needs conclusive evidence that AF is Midway before deciding how to commit his meager forces. He orders a false uncoded radio message be sent from Midway to naval headquarters, stating that fresh water machinery has broken down on the atoll. 2 days later, a Japanese intercept is picked up, cautioning invading troops to carry extra rations of fresh water. It is enough to convince Nimitz that he must risk his entire fleet and engage the enemy. He concludes the Aleutians are a diversion and decides to set his own trap for the Japanese armada at Midway. But he has only two carriers at his disposal. Weeks earlier, the Yorktown was severely damaged at the Battle of Coral Sea and was forced to return to Pearl Harbor for extensive repairs.
Nimitz said to the repair chief, "How long is it going to take you to get this ship repaired?" And he said, 3 months. And he said, "I'll give you 3 days."
It is a deadline that has to be met. In less than 60 hours of round-the-clock work, the Yorktown is patched up and ready to join the carrier group. Despite a web of Japanese surveillance around Pearl Harbor, the three American carriers slip out undetected. The Yorktown, Hornet, and Enterprise take their position at Point Luck, a rendezvous spot northeast of Midway. With less than 30 warships confronting more than 190 of Japan's crack naval vessels, their only hope is to launch their planes on the unsuspecting Japanese carriers before they are discovered. But all the Americans can do now is wait for Yamamoto to make his move.
The more they briefed us on what we were coming up against, it's kind of hard to visualize that all these ships and carriers and coming in was practically overwhelming.
But I had a wife and daughter living in Honolulu, and I was concerned in case the Japanese kept going it again. So I addressed Admiral Spruance, and I said, "Suppose they don't hit Midway. We have all our forces out here, but go on, keep going east and hit Pearl again." And he said, "We just hope they won't." And I thought, boy, that's cold comfort. We hope they won't.
On the 3rd of June, Japanese forces begin their invasion of the U.S. bases on the Aleutian Islands. It is the first confirmation that American intelligence has successfully decoded Yamamoto's intricate plan.
When we began to get reports from the Aleutians that they were under attack, all of a sudden it was too good to be true. It's too good. Here we're waiting in ambush for them. We're finally going to get the revenge that I've been hungering for ever since December the 7th.